On the same topic.
You're not in my room anymore. He said, then you'll have to go get your own.
It's all good. Everybody should change.
Kodesh, and to know how she has been a light and really spread her light of Torah to touch and connect to so many souls throughout this community. And that and roped in her buddy, good friend, I think twisted an arm a little bit, Laura Cazali. The two of them really, really drove this home.
That's for best
and they will give credit to the other people who were part of making it really happen. So I'll leave that up to them and Laura. Yeah.
Sydney, Dolly, and Chava. So Gary alluded to this earlier, that the committee that had the honor of honoring Morah Yehudis was amazing. And some of you know that I put out some desperate pleas for help to do this, because many of you know me as an educator, but not as an event planner. And for those of you that have worked on events, know there's a tremendous amount of work. And if you haven't, then you're just gonna have to bear with us as we appreciate and acknowledge all the people that made this a major success. And that's really, really important, because the spirit and the neshamas and the dedication of so many people comes from a deep place of Tikkun Olam in the world that's inspired by Morah Yehudis' amazing Torah. So Gary did say that I roped in a major buddy of mine who's standing right next to me, Laura Kazali, who is an event planner extraordinaire.
No.
Okay, she's not for hire, but she does not say no to committees. So anyway, it is my pleasure to present you with this beautiful gift. And may your Shabbos table be always filled with nourishment, laughter, and Torah, and fill your soul so that you receive as much as you give out to so many.
As you know, when Deb wants to do something, look out. Thank you. And there was so many other people that worked on this that were critical to making it happen. I really didn't have that much of a role compared to what Deb did and other people, but thank you for thanking me. I really appreciate it. I want to ask Shari Kark and Chaya Major and Ketriella Goldfeder to come up, because we want to acknowledge you, because you guys were amazing. Ketriella, you know, she's got three little kids. She's married to the rabbi. She's busy all the time, and she managed to pull this food off. Shari was like, well, what do you want? Do you want a video? Do you want this? Do you want that? She's pulled it out of her hat. She's just a phenomenal woman, got an incredibly positive attitude all the time.
Come on.
I want to take lessons from her.
Come on.
Just amazing. And Chaya, I don't think I need to say much about Chaya, because we all know she does everything everywhere for everyone. So please come up, please. Shari, Katriella, Chaya, please. Can't get him to come up on the stage. Okay, Shari, you really do have to come up here.
Shari needs to
really do have to come up here. Yeah. Or Chaya's gonna run away. But we all know that she does amazing things. I also want to say that, guess what we have tonight in addition to this? We have Shari's birthday.
So, oh, my birthday.
Shari,
it was in the fall, but we didn't acknowledge it. And it
so we're going to acknowledge it now. And otherwise known as Dr. A, who's an amazing teacher. Just, you know, her attitude is unbelievable. And she's beautiful and amazing, and she's 70.
Woo!
Isn't that something? So we'd like to sing happy birthday to her.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Shari. Happy birthday to you.
We love you.
I just want to say one thing. When I came in here tonight, and saw all of you, such dear, dear people, I thought, gee, this feels like a birthday party. I don't know why that went through my mind. I had no idea. None whatsoever. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And of course, there's other people that were involved in making this happen too that were really important to it. Shelley Levine, if you've had any ever had great desserts, she is amazing.
You're not going to have great desserts tonight. You're going to have stupendous desserts.
Outrageous desserts. And believe me, they're outrageous because she's amazing. So Shelley, if you can please come up. And Karen Shad, who was really a huge part of making the Tehillim book happen. And just, once again, she's just such a positive force to be around. It's just awesome. And Randy Tanser, who was also a key part of making that beautiful Tehillim book happen. And Nikki Goldberg, who was like at the very last minute, okay, I need to add this in and add this in, and just you know, it was like, just let it come at her and kept going with it. It was just awesome. I want to thank Dwayne. Dwayne, can you stand up? I see you over there. Hey. Yeah, the website is like...
I'm not kidding myself.
She's all done.
Brett, first of all, Morah Hashem, you're here. And any of us know what that means. And Randy's son, Brett, just did an amazing job. Anybody has a copy of that, or will get a copy of that. It's absolutely amazing. And you know that Tehillim, or what Yehudis is all about, and Randy and Brett really know that, and they wanted to bring that to our... So I want to just acknowledge our sponsors for tonight. Thank you for bearing with us. If it's too much verbiage, please join the committee next year. And you can give your 2 cents. Okay, so the sponsors are Bai Realty.
What, you're sneezing?
Sally family, the Vine family, IPS. The Millennium Hotel, they do an amazing job and they're awesome to work with. Boulder Jewish Day School. Woo! Hey, Tama, love that one.
Smile.
And Javier.
A long time ago, Reb Zalman had introduced us to a rabbi from Israel, one of the big Breslov Hasidim experts, Rabbi Gedaliah Fleer. And we were starting to cast about for ideas on, could we find a young rabbi that would come here? Could we afford a rabbi? Could we afford anybody? And Gedaliah Fleer said, you should hook up with Morah Yehudis Fishman. Actually, he didn't call her Morah, he said Yehudis Fishman. He put it very, very, with great understatement. He said, she's a wonderful teacher. She's a very good teacher. So we kind of tucked that away in our memory. And about 3 years later, on my caller ID, I got a call from Yehudis Fishman. And I said, oh, I've been meaning to call you for a while. So we talked, and then I think the other people that get significant credit for as Shatran are Tuvia and Jane Brandt, who really urged us to bring Yehudis here. And we had her here for a Shabbaton. And yes. We had her here for Shabbaton. It was love at first sight. We had her here for another couple of Shabbaton. She came here for Rosh Hashanah 1 year. It was very strong. And when we got around to really asking ourselves the question, who were we ready to hire? We had two other rabbinic candidates. One fellow had written a book this thick on the use of the Hebrew term klomar. Where's Rabbi Goldberg? Okay. A book this thick on the term klomar is used in the Gemara. I mean, this is a significant Hebrew text that was written. Another fellow was very strong musically, one of Reb Shlomo's mismachim. But we decided that the best man for the job was not a man at all. It was Yehudis Fishman, and the board was unanimous in that sentiment. So, I'm actually going to do a David Letterman-style top 10 on Yehudis, as though 10 could even get to the real depth of who Yehudis is. Many of you may know that Yehudis spent time in Santa Fe, and so item number 10 is her amazing, amazing harif guacamole. This was one of the benefits from Santa Fe. On a more serious note, Yehudis' emunah and bitachon is among the deepest of anybody I've ever seen. And as we all know, being an Orthodox Jew in Boulder is not such a simple thing. There's many challenges that are presented every day that pull you or could pull you away from the path. Yehudis has been very clear in her direction through all of these challenges, knowing that the schar is going to come on the other side in the Olam Haba, not in this world. And she has not strayed from her path at all. At the same time, she has not hurt anybody in the process. I think she's been very genuine and kind, maintained her integrity. So number 9 is Emunah and Bitachon. How many of you were at Purim a couple of years ago when Eliana Kinderler had her fabulous costume? Does anybody remember that? She dressed up as Yehuda. So item number 8 is Yehuda's really amazing sense of dress. And Eliana nailed it to a T, including the head covering. I don't know where she got the sweater. It was your sweater. Oh, there you go. Okay. Item number 7, Zrizut alacrity to do a mitzvah. So when the time finally came that my son Raphael Noam was born, Yehudis was living in Santa Fe. And we were scheduling the bris for a Friday morning and there was going to be a Shabbaton. Yehudis took a bus and stayed up all night to get to the bris. And I guarantee you, this is the first of many things that I've seen Yehudis do where she's very, very quick to do a mitzvah and does it in a very quiet and delicious way. Item number 6, Ahavat Yisrael. You know, this term gets bandied about, love of Israel. And Yehudis is really able to walk that path. Whenever she meets somebody, I think the essence of Kiruv is the person that's doing the Kiruv maintaining who they are and not asking the person that's being the Karaved to change in any way. There's just a meeting and letting people be who they are. And Yehudis has this amazing ability. It's not like this kind of greedy Kiruv, which is, you know, oh, we got to get you in, get you in. Yehudis just walks her way. She's doing her Ahavas Yisrael as she does it. And it's the most beautiful Kiruv in the world. Thank you, Yehudis. Does anybody know what the closest thing to a vice is that Yehudis has? Have you ever been to a bookstore with Yehudis? Yehudis has more books than Carter's got pills. It is just amazing. I think there are 2 garages in her apartment that are filled with books. I think she was barely able to clear out some of the garage so that somebody else's belongings could go in there. Her house is filled with books. Her credit card is filled with books. So item number 5 is books, and it's just an amazing legacy. I think Yehudis really views the books as friends. They're not inanimate objects. They're living things to Yehudis. Item number 4. It's just Yehudis' simplicity and her anava. I've often said, and it's tough to honor Yehudis because she's so hidden and so modest, but I've often said that I think that the reason that Aish Kodesh is able to continue is maybe because of how Yehudis takes her challah, or maybe how she lights the Shabbos candles. I don't know what it is that she does, but I think we all feel the force of whatever it is she brings to us in this world. Item number 3, her knowledge of Chassidut. So often often you'll find people who are knowledgeable in really just one area of Chassidut, and they're very deep. Yehudis has spent so much time with all of the Hasidic scholars and all the Sfarim. So she is both broad and deep. And I remember when we started learning Breslov Hasidus together, just the way she took that on. And the way, Yehudis, you're able to really integrate the teachings from all of these great teachers of ours. Item number 2, her kindness and her generosity. Everybody knows that the salaries at Aish Kodesh are not like the salaries at Microsoft. Reb Gavriel, you want to debate that? Somehow, some way, Yehudis is always able to come up with a gift for a child, for a simcha, for an adult. I don't know how you do this, Yehudis. I don't know if there's some special trust fund that you have, which would be absurd given your background. I don't know how you're able to do this, but you're always able to find money to give a gift to somebody, and it is one of the most beautiful and moving things in the world.
Power of the Master.
Okay, the Rabboni Shlalem. So then item number one, everybody knows that Yehudis likes to make puns, so I would say that item number one is that Yehudis is her own best audience. And it actually goes through like a four-layer thing. This is not like the four worlds, but the sort of the dawning, the awareness that there might be a pun, sort of this awakening of the neural cerebral cortex. Then there's the editors, and then there's the brand, and it's just amazing. And your puns are as enjoyable as your enjoyment of your puns.
Yeah.
So I look forward to going punim upon him with you more and more in the future. So, with that being said, again, these are just a few of the amazing and wonderful things about Morah Yehudis. We're blessed to have her. We have another member in the audience here who has a greater longitudinal perspective, who needs no introduction. That is Rabbi Zalman Schachter.
When Rabbi Yehudis is sitting there and I'm standing here, it's like in this some enchanted evening, right? And then on the other side of the room, and so on and so forth, as the song goes. So I wanted to stand much closer to you, Rabbi Yehudis. But then I said to myself, tonight I should be talking to them, not to you. Want to talk with you? We can talk. One of the reasons why I am here is because I bring with me some history. Was it in the 50s, 60s, Worcester, and all that, and I would be hearing about a Yehudis Fishman, sorry, Yehudis Fishman. And this is a young woman, was versteht Chassidus. Now, I want you to understand what kind of a compliment that is. There are some people who know stuff, but verstehen, you know, that's a much deeper thing. And so, I'd like to take what we heard from Rabbi Yonatan and say this is more the outer Rabbi Yehudis that was described. I'd like you to think back with me to the 50s, the 60s, what it was like in America trying to say something for a deeper level of Yiddishkeit outside of New York. You got to remember the outside of New York. If you lived in Brooklyn, then you knew there was such a thing as out of town. And out of town was like Siberia, you know? So when you start to look around what was happening in the out of town places and how Yiddishkeit had to be seeded there, and Rabbi Yehudis lived there, learned there, and was blessed in some way that it wasn't happening in New York, where people would be looking down her throat. But understand that when she takes time in Davenin and wants to be in the presence of the living God, that this is very real to her. And she was able to do that there. And with that experience and with what you find in the holy books, there is a connection, because the experience makes you see what the writer of those holy books meant when they said. Because without the experience, you would have only seen the chitzoniyut, the outer part of that. But when you start to daven, when you sing and niggun, when you try to go inside of yourself and see yourself in the presence of the living God, and being concerned for picking up the sparks in the world and for helping other Jews to come to their tikkun and to help the world to come to the tikkun. That's the kind of stuff that goes so deep prior to the place where one is born. That goes to that place where one has heard deep in the neshama the voice of God that says, whom shall we send and who will go for us? And that person says, I will go. And that men should do, that was around before, but in the years that Rabbi Yehudis began her soul's journey, that wasn't around. So she was in some way breaking a barrier that could be followed by other women afterwards to be able to combine deep experiential emunah with the material learned from books. So, one Rebbe, and she'll remind me who it was asked by his son, Papa, there has to be 36 tzaddikim, and you have said on such and such a tzaddik that he is a lamed vovnik, but he is well known in the world, so how could you call him a lamed vovnik? Aren't the lamed vovnik is hidden tzaddikim? And he said, mein kind, was upon him wollten mir gehat, al was er weiß sich in Dresden, is was lebt in a wenig. He said, what kind of a face would we have if that which lives on the outside also lives on the inside? There's a much deeper inside stuff that's happening than what is known. And I think I want to talk about this a little bit more. Could you be in touch with, in your neshama, with something that you heard from Rabbi Yehudis? And even if you can't remember it, but do you remember that feeling that went inside of the gut that says, aha, this feels like the word of the living God to me. Yeah? Aha. And if you can be in touch with that, then you can understand something as to why you should do what I'm about to ask you to do. There's a bracha that we make when we meet a person who is great in Torah. And I'd like this bracha to be said so by all of us. And I'd like Rabbi Yehudis to deeply, deeply enjoy the omen to the Rabbeinu Shlalom with that. So I'll say a word and you'll repeat, but for this one you should be standing. Rabbi Yehudis, you sit. Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Asher Halak Meirato Mechochmato Liireyav. I'm having trouble with that formula because you have to change some of it into the feminine and the masculine. And this is very nice because the first time that you say that, that I know of saying that to a woman, Asher Halak Mechochmato Liireyav. Amen. Now, having done this, and sit down because she's a little bit embarrassed, for years I've carried in my heart the wish to be among the people who give you smicha. And for years, you have managed to avoid it. But now it has happened as a fact that so many people made that broche, so you should feel yourself ordained, empowered, and blessed. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Okay.
what can I not say about Morah Yehudis Fishman? She is always there with a yummy, delicious baked good, an amazing, brilliant Torah that you never even knew you needed, and shows up at every event throughout the Boulder Jewish community. So without her in my life, for my daughter, my son, and my family, there would be a little less light and a little less sparkle. So thank you, Yehudis, for shining brightly in Boulder.
This is for Yehudis, who I love. Amar Rabbi Akiva, Amar Rabbi Akiva, Le'ahavta lo'reicha, re'icha, lo'reicha kamocha, Zekla gadol b'Torah, Amar Rabbi Akiva.
So there's just not enough words to bless you with. So I'm not going to share any. This is the bubbles. I was supposed to parade her up, but you know, it's just yay, bubbles. Because you fill our lives with bubbles and bubbles of light and Torah. So we are honored to present you with a token of sparkleness and love and light that you bring to us. There's something in there. You don't have to open it down.
Not a book?
Not a book. Who can buy a book for Yehudis? I mean, please. That she doesn't already have. So, it's my incredible honor to present to you all Morah Yehudis Fishman.
So with me, as with Aish Kodesh, the reports of our demise have been greatly exaggerated. Now, seriously, you read stuff about people who have near-death experiences, and I feel so blessed in my life because what the people come back with from those experiences are a sense that the most important things in life are acquiring wisdom and good friends. And hopefully, in my life, I've done both, and all of you have been responsible also for both, so I want to thank you very much for that. There's a bumper sticker that we should only be the kind of people that our dog thinks we are. But I'd like to expand that a little. You know, we should be only the kind of people that, I should be the kind of person that my community thinks I am. And just to reverse the dog part, I should only be the person that God wants me to be. Amen. Many years ago, I was teaching in Boston. I had a first grade student. Her name was Meira. And she was a beautiful, quiet little girl, kind of like Chaya Werman reminds me of in the day school. And my mother belonged to the Cerebral Palsy Club, so she used to take me to the circus when I was a kid. That was part of the kind of group experience there. And so I got hooked as an adult, and I wanted to go to the circus, but I was kind of embarrassed to go on my own. So I asked this little girl, Meira, her name is Meira Yisraeli, if she wants to go with me. So she was very happy and excited to go with me. And we had a great time. And the day after, I found a note on my desk. It's a first grade girl. And she says, Morah Yehudis, And I thanked her for, you know, making me able to go to the circus with her. And she said, Morah Yehudis, more than what you have done for me, more than what I have done for you, you have done for me. So I want to repeat that note to everybody here. There's a saying, Ein melech below om, there's no king without a kingdom, there's no teacher without students, there's no rabbi without a congregation, hint, hint. But I find what's really, really unique about Boulder, and I think tonight really says it all, so many people from cross-cultural, from all different congregations and denominations, are just being here as Yidden, as B'nai Israel. And I think that says so much for Boulder. I really feel that everybody in Boulder is a kind of, I would call it, designer Jew. One of a kind, unique. And on the East Coast, one of the, I say problems on the East Coast is there are a lot of people that are kind of cloned. When I was living in Boston, I had different rabbis and teachers, and then the first time I went to New York, I said, wow, there's like triples and quadruplets of all the rabbis I know in Boston, because they kind of all look alike. But in Boulder, you can't really say that. So that's my model of designer Jews. There's somebody, by the way, who wanted to be here tonight, Rabbi Engel, from Denver, but his daughter just had a baby boy in New York, so he wanted me to express his regards to everybody. Tonight happens to be a special day, today and tonight. Today, the 16th of, people know I'm into yahrzeits and calendar dates, special things that happen on special days. So the 16th of, what is it, Adar, I think? 16th of Adar. Happened to be the day that the sixth Lubavitcher Rebbe, Reb Zalman's Rebbe, Reb Yosef Yitzchak, got his naturalization, became an American citizen, and the best smile you could ever see on his face is that picture. Remember that picture when he actually signed his citizenship papers? And if not for him, I probably wouldn't be here either, because I was very close to his successor, the seventh Lubavitcher Rebbe. Tonight also, today also happens to be, the 16th of March, also happens to be my mother, Aleha Sholem's English birthday, her secular birthday. So I'm sure she was pulling strings in Shamayim to make this day happen. And finally, in terms of dates, tonight is a special birthday, the 17th of Adar, of a very, very special close friend of mine who you've seen in person and on stage, Karen Chat. So I want to take a few seconds for all of us here to send her special light and bracha of refuah shlema and everything good and nachas from her whole family, and she should get back a thousandfold of everything she puts out for the Jewish community. Kind of in honor of Karen, just for a few minutes here, and especially since Rich retired, I'd like to do a little shtick here. A little Jewish shtick, a little commercial break for Gary, but also a little shtick in honor of Karen to make her smile. I put myself to sleep for nights and nights trying to think of things, so I hope I don't put you to sleep, but I just want to... Few different ideas. You know, we're right now in a very special time in the Jewish calendar. We're in the part, the Torah calendar that talks about these four special portions, the Dalet Parshios. And so we're exactly right in the middle. We already read about Amalek. We read about giving the half a shekel. This Shabbos is coming up about the red heifer. And then the Shabbos afterward about the new moon of Rosh Chodesh. So there's a story about a woman who passed away, and she was going to heaven, and she was met at the gates, and they asked her a question. They said, why is it that you were married four times? And the angel is looking at the list, and it says, the first time you were married to a banker, the second time to an actor, the third time to a travel agent, and the fourth time to a mortician. So she had a very ready answer. She said, you know the old line, one for the money, two for the show, three to get ready, and four to go. So the rabbis here, I'm sure, will get the connection with all the four portions that we're in the middle of. So there's a story in New York about someone who, a young aspiring Buddhist who goes over to one of the ubiquitous hamburger hot dog stands and says, make me one with everything. And he takes out a big bill and gives it to the hot dog guy, and the hot dog guy puts it in his pocket and gives the guy the hot dog but doesn't give him any change. And so the young aspiring guru asks, where's my change? So the nice Jewish hot dog man says, young master, don't you know change must come from within? So those weren't mine, but I thought of a few original ones. So you know, where does the idea, I'm always challenging everybody and saying anything interesting in the world has its roots in Judaism. So where does meditation come from in Judaism? Aside from Rabbi Nachman, Bodhidut, you don't really have a sense of meditation being a mainstream occupation. But I say it is, and where does it come from? So you know the basic Jewish law that you have to start teaching even young children. When you have a meat meal and you want to have milk, you have to wait for 6 hours and wait and wait and wait. So if that's not meditation, then there's this bumper sticker I saw the other day. Another one. This is a real one. That says, I saw it on the way home from shul actually, that says, Jesus saves, Buddha invests. But it didn't say anything about, you know, it didn't have a Jewish source. So I was walking home, I have my 40-minute walk on the way home from shul, so I was thinking to myself, what does Moses do? Thinking and thinking and thinking and thinking. So then I had a flash of Torah being lifted up in the shul, and I said to myself, Moses says, roll over and over and over. So, you know, when I first came out west, I came to Santa Fe, and then I came to Boulder, and you have to talk a different language, basically. You can't talk straight Judaism to people. I mean, you have to, you know, couch it in a language, kind of, I call it lost in translation. So, you try to talk about obligations, Mark knows this, try to talk about chiyuvim. You can't really say obligations. You have to say maybe something like karmic debt. You try to talk about 613 commandments, that doesn't always go over so well. But when you say, as Reb Zalman might put it, web links to God. Then you talk about tshuva, repentance, so everybody knows repentance is not really the right word. So you said return, okay, that doesn't always do it for everybody. But then you say something like, an altered state. People here get that. You talk about a tzaddik, a righteous person, what's that? But then when you say somebody who's self-actualized, then they get it. Talk about the code of laws, what's that? a higher value system. Now we understand. Reward and punishment, not PC for Boulder. But you talk about cosmic consequences, then we know. And finally, halacha, Jewish law, also doesn't appeal to many people. But you translate it literally as, way to go. Because if you try to, you know, try to come to a place like Boulder or Santa Fe, and you use your East Coast Hebrew, you're going to get very confused, and especially confuse other people. You know, you mention Yiddishkeit to somebody, and they imagine, they picture a UFO with a mug and dove on it. You say, "Can I have something parved?" And they think you're using a golf term. You ask for Baba Ganoush and they send you to an ashram. You want a chauffeur and they think you're decadent. You ask for a Kanish and they bring you something in the shape of elephants. You say Yom Kippur and they point you to a store that sells very delicious fish. I can't read the next one. But you mention the word menorah, and they point you to a doctor who deals with women's issues. All right, so much for the shtick. So this little girl, Meira, who I taught, I actually connected with her a few years ago. And turned out she was one of the first Hilltop children, Hilltop teenagers in Israel. And I felt so, so proud of her. And I thought to myself, of being here in Boulder on a mountaintop, and how powerful the idea that one person can make a difference. And I think it's because the power of one person, comes when somebody is tapped into the power of one, the capital one. The year after Shlomo Kalbach passed away, a few of us teachers who were used to teach with him were hanging out in Copaic in the retreat place in the Catskills where we used to have an annual retreat. I'm still in routine. And we were all talking about what each of us got from Shlomo's legacy. David Zeller felt he got his music, and Sammy and Trader, his ability to tell Hasidic stories. And I didn't say anything. I was just crying and crying and crying, but I was talking to Shlomo inside myself, and I said, "Shlomo, please, 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 give me a shtickle, a little piece of your Avas Yisrael. That's all I want. All I want for you to go with me, take you with me through the rest of my life. And hopefully tonight really manifest that, I think." There's a commentary of Rashi on this week's Parsha where Hashem is talking to Moshe and he says, "Hinei makom iti, behold, there's a place with me." And Rashi says from Medrash Tanchuma, it's not saying that Hashem is in a place, it's saying place is with Hashem. That God is the place of the world. So when we're in the presence of one, we're in that place of oneness together with God. I know I told the story frequently, but it's one of my favorite stories, a discussion about a mystic and a philosopher met, and they both compared notes on what they think about, the first thought that they have when they wake up. So the philosopher says, I wake up and I look at myself and I wonder how God fits into my world. And then the mystic said, I wake up and I feel the presence of God and I wonder how I fit into God's world. So I hope, and I know most of you I know here really are veering toward the latter and really have an understanding that Hashem is the ultimate reality of the world. In that same context in the Torah, we're told that Hashem put Moshe benikrat hatzur, in the crag, in the crack of the rock. So what does that mean? And many years ago, I read a commentary from Rav Amiel, who I think was the chief rabbi of Tel Aviv, who said, you know what Hashem was teaching Moshe? How Hashem was teaching Moshe that in the most solid, materialistic aspect of this world, if you really go deep, deep, deep inside, you find that empty space, which is God. That is the makom et, that is the place. That is the et that should phone home and ask for God to be more real, as Rabbi Steinzel says in the Tanya class I'm teaching at Aish Kodesh, more real than the heart, than your own heartbeat. When you can feel that, then nothing in life can knock you out. So during this time of the year, we're in a special place of Achdus. Purim unites all Jews. Esther, before she went into the king, she said to Mordechai, go, gather in, Knos es kol ha-Yehudim, gather in all the Jews together. Make sure everybody, men, women, and children, are praying, because that's what Amalek tried to destroy, that sense of unity that the Jews have on a neshama level with each other. And we're moving to Pesach, and we know the Maharal has a teaching about Pesach. Everything about Pesach is about unity. Jews had to eat in groups. The Korban Pesach, the Paschal Lamb, had to be roasted in one wholeness. It's all about coming together. It's all about recognizing what we have in common rather than what separates us. And then finally, we move on to Shavuot, the climax of Jewish life. As Rafi says, his favorite portion is Shavuot, because God gave all the Jewish people the Torah. And who was I telling? I was telling somebody the other day that I was telling Mark on Purim that I cried one year in Santa Fe when I somebody brought me over the latest reform platform, and it said, didn't we all stand together at Sinai? And that was the kind of concluding message of the platform. So again, what brings us together is much, much stronger and deeper and more than what separates us, than when what brings us apart. And the future, we know that when I first came to Boulder, there wasn't that much Judaism in Boulder, but it's grown by leaps and bounds in the last 5-10 years, as everybody can see and knows. And so what's the future gonna be? So I'm speaking really on behalf of Aish Kodesh, because if not for them, I wouldn't be here. And Rav Gavriel is working so hard to bring, talking about unity, to bring an Erev to the community, a encircling symbolic fence that doesn't exclude but rather includes everybody and allows people to carry on Shabbat. And so I hope that that symbol of the Erev is not just an Erev in a physical sense, it's an Erev that really, really, really brings together people in the most original and unique and deep ways. And we also know there's a mikveh in Boulder, and mikveh also means a gathering, a collection, mikveh mayim, a collection of water. So that also should be a very positive omen for Jewish unity in Boulder. But I think the most important thing that I see, that I really feel, especially in terms of the future of Boulder, is the Jewish day school. And nobody asked me, but I really, really want to put a plug in for the day school. And I hope really everybody can support the day school in one way or another, through kids, through prayers, through money, whatever it takes, through fixing, because this is a community school that really allows the future to continue. And I have to tell you, I've taught many places in the country, but I have never seen maybe it's the generation that we're in, you know, the idea of the indigo children, but I've never seen children as bright and spiritually connected as the children in the day school. And I want to just share with you a minute of some gems from the kids in the school. So, I think I mentioned Gary a while ago, I was teaching them about Matan Torah and the Parsha of Yitro, and I taught them about the concept of Naseh and Nishma. First we'll do it, and then we'll try to understand. And after I taught them that, I showed them a little, I'd shown the older kids a little video of Rashi, the biography of Rashi. So the kids, the little kids, the first grade and kindergarten, begged me, can we please see the video? So I said, that video, I think, is a little too old for you. So before I can show you the video, I have to explain some of the things in the video. So at least three kids in the first kindergarten, first grade, raised their hands and said, Morah Yehudis, you said, Naseh v'Nishma, we have to see it first. Then we were talking about the difference between people and angels, and the idea that, so we talked about all the mitzvahs, everybody said a mitzvah that angels cannot do, that only people can do. And little Dahlia, who you saw here tonight, rolled her cute little eyes and raised her finger, shook her finger, and pointed to her head, and she said, and this is a great title for a book, Morah Yehudis, Angels Don't Wear Shekels. Then there's a boy, Max, who's just been introduced to Judaism for a few months. And we were talking about tefillin. And I came back the next day and I said, who can, if somebody didn't know what tefillin were, how would you describe them? And Max raises his hand and he says, Jewish headlights. Then we were talking about why the Torah has to start with Bereshit, all the stories in Bereshit. Why doesn't it just start with laws? Why does it talk about all the stories about the patriarchs and matriarchs? And little Nathan Woodward raises his hands and in his very intense, emotional way says, we have to have someone to learn from. Then there's a boy named Jake, a very inward, thoughtful boy, and I came back to school yesterday and I gave out shalach manos, and the kids were telling me the term that they learned was mishloach manot, but little Jake said, I think they're really called mashiach manot. And then we were also talking about why God created the world, and he said, well, if God is good, he has to have some people to be good, too. Little first grader. Then, of course, Chava, with all her different stories that I've told many times, but I was talking about some Kabbalistic rabbi saying that there's a possibility that Mashiach's coming is imminent, and she didn't say anything, but she grabbed her heart and she said, as only Chava can do, that's speaks volumes. And then finally, one of the most touching things, Sydney, who you've seen in the video and who's here tonight, Sydney Ghazali, the branch doesn't fall far from the tree, she told me that if God forbid she were ever to lose her parents, the first place she would go to is a shul, because she knows where her real family is. Thank you, Sydney, for that. So much have I learned, as the Talmud and Tanya says, from my teachers, much from my peers, but from my students most of all. I woke up this morning, you know, Rabbi Nachman says that each night our souls are given a new Torah. And when we wake up, the evil inclination tries to make us forget it. So if we wash our hands in the correct way, then we can remember that Torah. So I woke up this morning with another saying from Ethics of the Fathers, Lo alecha hamlocha ligmor. It's not upon you to finish the work. But you're not exempt from leaving it. So I thought this idea, lo alecha hamlacha ligmor, doesn't just mean you don't have to finish it. It means lo alecha hamlacha ligmor. It's not only upon you to finish it. You have much, much help. You have help from your friends, your communities, and you have help from higher up. So I want to bless us all, this really very, very, very special community, Aish Kodesh especially, who, as all of you know, is not a closed community. It's open to everybody. And Rav Gavriel and Katriel are working really so, so hard to reach out to everybody and to make everybody feel welcome. So the last thing I want to say is, a journey of 1,000 miles begins with a single oi!
Oi! Another really important person in this community that's been unbelievably amazing for our family, for the shul, who's absolutely brilliant, a musician, groovy, interesting, fun, wonderful to talk to, full of Torah beyond my wildest dreamings, and that I've learned so much from, that my family has learned so much from, is Reb Gavriel Goldfeder, and I'd like him to come up. And he's also going to start the boogieing. So, okay. Morah Yehudis.
Not yet. Baruch Hashem.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah. Groovy. So, I want to report to you that two unprecedented things happened tonight. One, as Rav Zalman told us before, that we had the opportunity to say a special bracha, which Rav Zalman claims was the first time that that bracha was said for a woman. And the second unprecedented event is that Yehudis has channeled the spirit of Rich Shad. Very, very mysterious. It's really, really wonderful to see Yehudis fulfilling her favorite chumrah in the entire Talmud and system of halakha. As it says in Ta'anit, Mishen nichnas Adar marvin besimcha, when Adar comes in, you have to increase your joy. And some people think it means increase your joy up until Purim, and then you start kvetching about getting ready for Pesach. But Yehudis is machmir l'mahadrin mina mahadrin, to remind us that the simcha of Adar goes far beyond Purim, and I think it just never stops. Purim. So I just need to say a couple things. One, there's a story in the Gemara, I think it's in Kedushin, somewhere around 29 or 30, where it says Rabbi Tarfon was phenomenal at honoring his parents, especially his mother. And he used to, so had such a thing that when she would walk, he would put his hands under her feet so that she wouldn't have to touch the ground. And everyone said, wow, this guy's really got this mitzvah kicked, right? This is his letter in the Torah. He's really getting it. And I think it was someone like Rabbi Akiva got up and said, no, 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 he hasn't even done the half of it yet. Everyone says, what does he mean? Rabbi Akiva is a smart guy. He must know something. So Rav Soloveitchik, 2,482 years later, comes along and says, here's what's going on with that story. A person comes into the world, they have a certain mission, they have a certain mitzvah, a certain gift that they bring to the world, and if they fulfill that gift to its entirety, they're done. So Rabbi Akiva got up and said, no, no, he hasn't done anything yet. To keep Rabbi Tarfon reminded that he still has what to do and still what to offer us, so I'm not going to be the one to do it, but Yehudis, we all know that you have plenty, 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 plenty more to offer us on many, 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 many levels, and we look forward to many, many years. I look forward to many, many years of working with you and learning from you. And in your honor, Yehudis, I decided tonight I was going to try to say a Dvar Torah in Yehudis style. And in order to do that, I had to analyze some of my records of her past Dvar Torahs. and try to isolate the formula. What is it? What is it? What is it? What is it? Morah Yehudis Torah? How do you bottle it and sell it? And so I thought, okay, so Yehudis is going to say something extremely, extremely relevant. She's going to pull off some sort of quasi-mathematical application of that principle to many examples. It's going to feel like it's Davka about you. It's going to be subtle. And she's going to make it look easy. So I decided I was going to try it tonight. I don't think I can make it look easy, but I'm going to give it a stab. So what I'm going to do tonight, I'll just tell you what I'm going to do, and then I'm going to do it, and then I'm going to tell you what I did. And then we're going to dance. So I'm going to attempt to explain this is a tightrope act, attempt to explain the concept of Tiferet. I'm going to apply it to Olam Shana Nefesh. I'm then going to make you feel good about yourselves, and then I'm going to challenge you, and then I'm going to pick up the guitar. Okay, Tiferet. Tiferet is a phenomenal, one of our favorite sefirot. Tiferet implies the capacity of different lights to overlap without negating each other, to coexist. It's often translated as harmony. And what we know about harmony is that, or Shlomo used to say, the difference between speaking and singing is that when you speak, if two people speak at once, no one can hear anything, and if you sing, then it sounds beautiful when people sing at the same time. So, the idea of harmony in the world of souls, Olam Shana Nefesh, it's one of those fancy things that cool rabbis pull off when they apply a concept to the Olam, which means the physical world, Shana, which is time.